listening to Humans of Mitti Ke Rang. Today we have with us a really special guest who actually introduced me to the world of podcast, Ashton Doctor. He's a podcaster at Habit Coach. He's a YouTuber at Awesome 180 and he has also founded Awesome 180, which is a habit program. Welcome to the podcast, Ashton. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm good. So would you like to tell us about how did this all journey begin for you?
Sure. So, you know, the whole idea of habit coaching started because I saw people trying to make a change in their lives and were just getting frustrated because there was no difference taking place. You know, that entire feeling of I want to do something. But after a while, you know, after 3-4 days, gone. Correct? Like, you know, how many times have people started to start a diet? Like, you know, if you're a listener and you put up your hand, if you actually, you know, started a diet and it failed in another day or two. Why? Because we kept relying on motivation. So what happened was I went through my own journey of change. When I started about, I think, 5 years ago, 5.5, 6 years ago, I was extremely unhealthy, overweight. I used to sleep maybe 3-4 hours a night, very stressed out. And you know, what happened was all of that started coming together. And I thought I was living the right life because I was earning lots of money. I was, you know, killing it. I was doing very well at work. And I thought that was how you're supposed to do. And I remember this so clearly. I was getting ready for a presentation one day and I collapsed on the floor because of all the stress and because of everything that was happening to me. And I remember my heart pounding in my chest. I remember, you know, pasina, sweat happening. And I'd never experienced something like that. That was genuinely very scary. And when you're in your early 30s, you don't want to be feeling like that. But what happened was that I kept thinking that, you know, this was actually a
wake-up call.
Not even a wake-up call. It was the ulta. It was a sense of pride. Look how hard I'm working and I could do this. You know?
Okay. So there was that society kind of like makes you feel that, yeah, you're doing good. If you're actually working that hard or if you're doing late shifts, that means that you're working hard enough.
Correct. Absolutely. You know? And then you wear it as a medal of pride. And that was what was happening. There was a part of me that was this medal of pride. And then there was the other part of me which was very scared. Correct? Which was the wake up call part. Mm-hmm. And after that, a period of time, I got out of this whole cycle and I said that I need to make a change. And for me, it said that if I want to get healthy, what is the hardest thing I can possibly do? So in my mind, from having a nice big pay to, it was get a six pack.
Okay.
How do I get six pack abs? And that's how my journey started. And while it started with that kind of a very vain goal of a body change, it completely changed and transformed because I suddenly realized how much energy I got, how my relationships with friends improved, how my relationship with my parents improved because I was on this healthier journey. And, you know, the way that you feel full of vitality and full of energy. And that's how it started changing. And my friends would look at me and say, you know, Baba, I can't do what you're doing. Right? I don't have your motivation. I don't have your discipline. You are too disciplined. And this is where, you know, it got stuck in my head now saying I'm not disciplined. All I did was I got the right information and I got the right habits. And that was that combination that was the winning success for me. So I wanted to see how I could replicate it for others. And in fact, this whole habit coaching business came to me in a meditation that I was doing while I was in Leh Ladakh. And the whole idea of what I need to focus on and everything came to me in that. And I was like, chalo, once I reach back to Bombay, we're starting this. And that's how it actually came about.
Okay, so since I am actually into now a lot of podcasts, I was listening to Ranveer Alabadi as well. So he has this thing, he says that gym is a place where he finds his motivation. If he's having a bad day, he'll go there. So is that same for you as well? Like, gymming is providing you that motivation? Like, it's all started with six apps. So I believe that there might be some relation to that.
So for me as well, when it started off, So before I got onto this journey of health or wellness, my self-esteem was completely destroyed. Correct? I had a very, very low self-esteem. And the gym actually helped me with that because I could see a change taking place every time I went to the gym, every time I, you know, every few months I would see that, oh, wow, new muscle. Oh, wow, my body's looking different. Correct? And I could feel that change, and which is what kept me going. So even now, whenever I'm feeling really tired, low, etc., when I exercise, I feel good. In fact, you know, people say that exercise is one of the most underrated antidepressants, because the kind of hormones that get released when you exercise completely changes your point of view, completely changes the way that you approach the world. So that's why exercise is so important, especially if you want to do a mood change. So absolutely right. Beer biceps is like full on point with that.
Okay, so one more thing that he says, and I also found in your podcast as well, you talk about meditation. You are like that, the biggest learnings that usually come, or you get to learn yourself even further through meditation. So how do you suggest for someone like me or a beginner, how should we get on with that? Like, just close your eyes and just start concentrating on breathing. That's all we know. So how do we start about it?
So the problem with meditation is that it's given that same kind of what you just described, you know, close your eyes and then no thoughts. Impossible. Not going to happen. Right. Yes. Because thoughts are going to come. And the problem is that we haven't understood what meditation is. And there are steps towards it, and you have to learn that. So there is the first step, which is introspection. Okay. Which is understanding how to be with your thoughts, allowing your thoughts to come, allowing yourself to think about those thoughts. Okay, so you spend a couple of months, maybe more, introspecting till your mind gets shunned from all the junk that is inside, from all the thoughts that are just running around inside. So it starts off with that. The second part that happens is a sense of mindfulness. Okay, so you go from that to place of mindfulness. So mindfulness are all those apps like Headspace, like your Calm. These are your meditation apps that are there. Okay. Sorry, I got a sneeze coming. You can edit that part.
It's okay.
So the next part is the mindfulness apps. So these are apps that, you know, take you to that place of observing your thoughts, calming your mind down, etc. Then you come to meditation. Meditation is completely different. There's a spiritual aspect of meditation, which is looking at your chakras, etc., which is very, 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 very different. And it takes a while to get there, or you need a good teacher or a guru to get there. But the mindfulness one is what people mostly stick around to, which is closing your eyes, focusing on your breathing. And the trick here is don't focus on removing your thoughts. Instead, observe your thoughts without passing a judgment on them. Right? So if suddenly biryani starts floating past your mind, right? Don't say, oh, I'm hungry. What should I do? Just say, interesting, biryani. Okay, gone. Right? If something else comes up in your mind saying that, oh, you know, that person said this to me yesterday, you know, I wish I'd said this to him back. Correct? Observe that thought without passing judgment. Is it a good thought or bad thought? Should I have that thought? Should I not? You know, what happens is as soon as we get a thought, we immediately go into judgment mode. Correct? And that is where this whole meditation practice starts failing. So in the mindfulness part, just start observing. Observing your breathing, observing your thoughts, observing the sounds that are around you. And, you know, there's a very nice meditation practice, which is the Zen meditation practice. And an aspect of it. So I was in Japan a year ago, and one of the people out there, there was a monk who taught this to us. And I didn't go to a monastery or something. It was just the one day thing that I had with him. I'm not saying that I'm a monk. But it was very nice because he took us through the mindfulness practice of first focusing on your breathing, then focusing on your ears, then focusing on keeping your eyes slightly open and just seeing what are the things that come in, but only observing. And then finally, we did a walking meditation where while walking, we were feeling the ground underneath our feet. So it was all aspects of our body that we were being mindful about. Mm-hmm. And that was so peaceful and calming because we're never in that kind of a situation alone.
Okay, so I believe walking meditation is something new for me. I would definitely research upon it. I also wanted to know, like, when you are doing walking meditation, so are you supposed to close your eyes and just walk and feel the grass underneath your feet or something like that?
So it is eyes partially open and taking in everything. And you're absolutely right. Every time you put your feet down, be mindful about the way that you're stepping. Where is your body weight? Are you walking fast? Are you walking slow? Are you just walking? Correct? All these thoughts will come to your mind. And that is good. Allow them to come. Play with them. Dance with them. That is the idea. It is not about, you know, saying that focus. Are you feeling the grass? Is it pokey? Is it not pokey? No, because that is passing judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, interesting. 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 Interesting.
Okay, so recently again, I was listening to one of the Gurujis. He is Gopal Das. You might have heard about
him. Yeah, yeah. Love it.
Yeah, so he has a lot of tips on meditation. One of them being that he says that if you want to incorporate meditation in your life, you can start by doing things, not multitasking, because once you start multitasking, your brain works in such a way that if you are even meditating, you will start multitasking in that as well. So try doing whatever you're doing, just focus on that. He gives an example by saying that, for example, if you're taking a bath, so just focus on taking a bath. I used to sing while taking a bath. Now I'm just focusing on the water that's coming on my body and feeling how it feels. So he says that you can start by incorporating these habits. So have you, do you have such kind of spiritual leaders or gurus that you follow?
So for me, it is my mom. So my mom is actually a spiritual leader in herself. She teaches a kind of meditation called Satya meditation. And, you know, being my mom, when I was passing through this phase of, you know, self-discovery and all of that, I didn't want to follow what my mom was telling me, right? Like, who wants to do what your mom is telling you to do, correct? So that was the last form of meditation that I actually went after. Before that, I tried all the mindfulness ones. I tried all the different kinds, all the breathing kinds and everything. And then finally I said, okay, mama, now tell me yours. And that's the one that I found the most peace with, because my mom's meditation is all about understanding your chakra system, the spiritual part. Remember I was telling you the spiritual part of it.
So and you can do it like with ease.
Now, because with practice, right? Okay. Like I was telling, you know, in a meditation, this whole awesome 180 thing came. You know, it's so interesting when you practice this and you suddenly start feeling this extreme oneness with everything around you. Like this branch outside my window, you know, in the meditation, you just like start floating in, you feel it's part of you and you start actually understanding that everything you see around is a part of you because you are perceiving everything as well. So, you know, these kinds of thoughts start coming up and the way that you observe your world changes. So, you know, there's one way of looking at it, like I used to, I was like, ah, it's a like, people are mad, right? Pagal hai, right? And that's fine. You know, if you're thinking pagal hai, that's perfectly fine right now. But see, maybe is there a possibility? Open your eyes a little bit more. Take a little baby step. See, I can't tell you to immediately jump and say that you and I are one. Correct? You'll say, rubbish, I'm me, how dare you? Correct? So these are baby steps that you take along the way. And like you were talking about being mindful while you are having a bath, it's a beautiful technique because we all are multitasking. Do I do it? No. Huh? I listen to podcasts when I'm in the shower. Okay, so I'm not going to be saying that I do these things, that I don't. But I understand the value, especially in a world where we are overstimulated. If you're not taking the time out. Like for tomorrow, for example, tomorrow, I'm not going to be starting my phone at all because I want that day of no stimulation from a screen.
Okay, so talking about your program, so does Awesome 180 program also include meditation and all these things in that?
At a later stage. Because remember I told you there is a journey that you have to follow.
So, so what the are the journeys?
Sure. So the Awesome 180 program is the foundation that you need to create that awesome life. Okay, then after that you can do whatever. So this is the foundation. And the foundation consists of six things. It consists of nutrition, means the food that you put inside, but this is not a diet. So it's not a diet plan that you get. It's understanding food. The second is movement, right? Are you moving your body enough? Our bodies were designed to move, but we spend 46% of our life sitting down. Why? Correct? So understanding movement and seeing that can we bring movement to our life? So not just the exercise plan. Then we have sleep, which is understanding what is the quality of sleep that you're getting, not just 8 hours. Because I've had clients who slept for 9 hours and got 45 minutes of deep sleep, which is nothing, correct? Like yesterday, I think I slept for, 6.5 hours and I got 3 hours of deep sleep. So there is a difference in the way that you can create that deep sleep cycles in your body and improve that. So that is one way of doing it. Then we have de-stressing. De-stressing is what? Not stress management, which is, you know, my shoulders are big, I can carry as much weight and stress as I can. But de-stressing is allowing yourself to let go of stress. You know, allowing stress to come and let go, and leave it on the side of the road while you're walking. Correct. So that is de-stressing. So as part of de-stressing, one of the things is meditation. So that is how we build meditation. Then we have breathing, which is one of the things that we, most of us, don't even focus on at all. Ho raha hai na, apne aap ho raha hai. Let it go, let it happen. But instead, we need to focus on it because it's a very, very powerful tool that we have. And the last is hydration. You know, there is no such thing as drinking 3 liters of water. There is no research done on just this much. But it is the way that you hydrate that is important. So that is what we cover in the program.
Yeah, and they do say, go on.
No, I was saying that many people wonder on, you know, how many of these are actually correct for them? How many of them do they have in place? And to our website, awesome180.com, there is a habit quiz that you can do. And it'll tell you exactly which ones of these you need to focus on first. So that is how you start thinking that, you know, if you want to listen to the podcast and do it or however, start looking at which habit you can focus on first. So go do that quiz for sure.
Okay, so after this podcast, I'm definitely trying that out. I do feel that it's a nice thing that you have free platforms for people and they can access all those informations on your podcast, on your YouTube channel. And if they're interested, they can even go to your website as well. And you even come up with different...
Yeah. And there's an app coming out as well. In fact, this week, there is an app coming out, which is a habit tracking app. So you can actually track your habits as it goes along. So all you'll have to do is search for Habit Coach or Awesome 180 on your Play Store or iPhone Store, and you'll find it there.
Okay, congratulations on
that. Thank you. I'm quite excited.
Even I'm excited. I've been hearing about it since 2 months, I believe. On your Instagram, I have been hearing every live you have been like, we are coming up with an app. So I'm definitely waiting for that.
Thank you.
Also, you do come up with diets like no sugar diet and all those. So don't you think that's... Yeah, challenge. Sorry. So don't you think it's quite excessive? Like most of the people are not able to quit sugar in their life. So that's quite a big challenge for them. So do you want people to follow through or you're just leading an example? Like if they want, they can come and join.
No, see, there's a big difference between habits and challenges. And that is why I separate the two. So a habit is something that I want you to have for the rest of your life. So meditation is a habit. Mm-hmm. Correct? But I don't want you to give up sugar for the rest of your life. Sugar is bad. Okay, there's no two ways around it. But sugar also gives that little masti to you. Nah? Sugar also gives those moments of fun. Sugar gives that moments of celebration. The problem is that excess of sugar. Every day in my chai. Every day in my this. So you become dependent. Mera shakkar wala chai nahi milega, so I will have a horrible day. You know, you become dependent on it. So the challenge is only so that you can break the dependency and realize that you're much stronger than what this is. So the challenge is only 30 days. After that, if you want to go back to it, go back to it. If you want to continue no sugar, continue no sugar. But 30 days, see how you feel after it has left your system. So that way we'll do a no sugar challenge. We'll do a no gluten challenge. We'll do all those things, but as a challenge.
But I do believe that doing these challenges let you know that what are the products that contain sugar. Like majority of the things, we are not even aware that we are getting sugar from those.
Absolutely. In fact, we've tied up with this company called Plan My Food for these challenges. And the Plan My Food app is amazing because it has every single product listed in India. So all you have to do is scan the barcode and it will tell you what are the ingredients in the product, whether you can have it or not. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm.
That's quite nice. You can actually regulate the intake as well as you will get to know what is there actually.
Absolutely.
Even I believe that most of the people who take these challenges are able to follow through a small duration of time. They might not be able to follow through, but they will gain that consciousness whenever they are buying something. So that's very, that's what comes out of this as an outcome.
Absolutely.
So do you yourself do not consume sugar, or you allow yourself cheat days, or it's like you do challenges and you learn from them and then try to incorporate them in your life?
So my first no sugar challenge happened about 4.5-5 years ago when I started this health journey. So I was going to the gym and I was starting to learn about food and I was eating oats instead of this and I was trying everything, correct? A friend of mine told me about her friend who was addicted to Coca-Cola. Okay. Mm-hmm. So she would drink about 2-3 liters of Coca-Cola every day, you know, those big bottles every day. Mm-hmm. And she started a 100-day no sugar challenge. And because of that, I said, chalo, I will support her. who I am. I still don't know what her name is. I told my friend to tell that person that I am supporting you. I'm also doing 100 days with you. Mm-hmm. So I did 100 days of no sugar. And I had no idea at that point of time what it entailed, because suddenly there was, I couldn't have biscuits, I couldn't have bread, I couldn't have tomato ketchup, I couldn't have mustards, I couldn't have, all these things contain sugar. And I had no idea. Correct? Mm-hmm. And I used to be the kind of person that would have ketchup on everything. Ketchup on my eggs, ketchup on my dal rice. If I could put ketchup on my ice cream also, I would have put it. You know, so like I would have had ketchup on everything. Mm-hmm. And I was feeling that lack. So then I started learning how I could make ketchup at home. I learned how I could do these things. So, you know, you get into that whole groove and you start learning so much. And the idea of these challenges is to learn. So it's 30 days. And that started ages ago. And earlier on, we used to do a lot of these free challenges. So, you know, you join me on a WhatsApp group and we'll keep communicating. And we had, I think, by now we would have had about 550 people who would have done it along with me like that.
That's amazing.
But the problem was they couldn't figure out what products contain sugar or not, because sugar has over 150 names. Mm-hmm. Cane sugar, demerara, muscovado, high fructose corn syrup, fructose. Mm-hmm. So you don't know what you're having. And as a result, people were making mistakes. So the reason why we actually created a formal program was now because we had the ability of telling people, eat this, not this. Eat this, not this. Eat this, not this. So that's why the formal program started. And as a thing, because we're doing this every month, I'm not eating sugar every month. So the only day I eat sugar is on the 31st of a month.
Okay.
Because so it's a 30-day challenge. So it ends on the 30th. So 31st I get. So like September didn't have a 31st. So no. So now October is the 31st, I'll look for that. And it's my birthday month. So 31st, I'll eat something.
Okay, so happy birthday in advance.
Thank you. Yes,
and I think cheat day is allowed on your birthday, I believe.
Treat.
Treat day. Okay, so what according to you is a cheat day and a treat day?
Cheat is negative, na? Matlab, what are you cheating on? Like, how can you expect anything to work if you're cheating? Mm-hmm. Correct? Treating is because you deserve it, you're doing it. Nah? So that little mindset change on this is cheat, this is treat, this is cheat, this is treat makes a big difference.
Okay. So since you are all about habit and all, you research about those things. So I want to know that how did you come up with this idea about talking about habits? Was it from your life that you saw that the habits have a lot of impact, so you should do a podcast on it? Or was it an idea that came across, just like, how did this whole process start exactly?
For the podcast itself?
Yes.
So the podcast started because I used to listen to podcasts for the longest time. Mm-hmm. 7-8 years ago, I used to listen to podcasts. And I always wanted to start one. And I had no idea that India had podcasts. So when I I started the habit coaching business, I said, that, chalo, let's make a podcast. And I went out and I bought a mic and I did all of that. And then suddenly I met somebody who runs a podcasting studio called IVM. And then we decided to start something together from there onwards. So it was actually a beautiful journey because, you know, it started off as a passion project and we had no idea it would turn into something this big and fantastic.
So I do believe whosoever actually watches your podcast, they might not be able to get those actionable habits in their life, but they do try. Like, I feel that I have watched around a lot of videos that you have, a lot of podcasts that you have posted, and I have tried to incorporate them. I am guilty of not following through for like 21 days, as scientifically they say, or 30 days for that matter. But I do try, and it is actually nice that you come up with these small tricks and tips to actually have them follow through, like people having them follow through, like you have micro exercise sessions and all these things. So how do you come up with these ideas? Is it like extensive research or something that you have gone through personally that you're able to inculcate all these things together?
So a lot of research, and every single habit except for one that I've put on the podcast, I have done. Correct. So
mobile phone one.
That's the only one that is the worst one for me. But everything else I have done and was successful, which is why I shared. So, so there are lots that I've done which were not successful because they didn't make a difference, which I don't share. So it is a mixture of lots of knowledge and self-experimentation. And to put in into perspective, it's been 300 episodes now. So there are 300 plus things that I would have incorporated in my life over these last 6-7 years.
So I believe that even your family is incorporating those things, because I believe your mother also joined you and into that challenge of no sugar and fasting. She's also trying along with you, right?
Absolutely. You know, like I keep saying that parents and friends are the last to change. Correct? Mm-hmm. Because everybody else, strangers will listen to you, your enemies will also listen to you, but your friends and your parents are like, arey, this is to Ashtin, what will he know? Correct? Mm-hmm. So they are the last to change. So you have to show them only through example. So you have to live that life, and then they'll come to you and say, okay, tell me, how do I do this? Tell me, how do I do this? So getting your parents to incorporate these things is the hardest and takes the longest. So, but once they understood it, they're all on board. So when we've been on the farm for the last 6 months, and when we started off, we were eating in dabba ke, because, you know, like chutti, you know, that's what lockdown was supposed to be. And then I told them that, you know, within a week or two, we were feeling really lethargic. We started putting on weight, and which was very off. So I said, let's start our fasting. And all of us started intermittent fasting for about 16 to 18 hours. So we did it together as a family, you know, so then that built up that momentum for us. I think all of us have lost quite a lot of weight on this during this lockdown.
Okay. So coming about the exercise part, so do you think even that you are able to inculcate in your family, like you are a very fitness freak, I would say, when it comes to like having
fitness enthusiast.
Okay. So I think throughout this podcast, I'll be learning few positive words, how to not use them in a negative way.
Correct.
Thank you so much for that. So yeah, are they having such impacts as well? Like, are they also getting into exercise and all?
My mom every morning is doing her exercise, and very, very strictly. So like, you know, there's music playing outside, then I'm doing my exercise, music playing here, different music for her, different music for me. Dad is harder to get to it, because he likes making his excuses, and he will do one set of exercise, then he'll sit down, he'll watch TV, he'll walk around. So his exercise is a little all over the place. I'm trying to be a little more strict on him, but ultimately something that has to come from him. So mom, for sure, she's hardcore, but dad is not.
Okay. So talking about your parents, do they also listen to your podcast and like incorporate those things in their life as well?
Yeah, yeah. Mom's up to date on all the podcasts. Because also sense of pride, no, for my parents saying, listening to it and things like that. And they're like, oh, I didn't know this. And my dad listens to the podcast, and he then quotes the podcast in our office meeting, saying that, oh, I heard this on Ashlyn's podcast. And, you know, so it makes me also feel nice that parents are listening in as well. So absolutely.
That's quite a proud moment. Also, what are three podcasts, or what are three habits that you believe are your favorite among all the 300 podcasts that you have made?
So one is Mind Your Mind. Mm-hmm. Okay. Which is, can you go through your mind and search for those golden nuggets that are there? Okay. This is something that we don't do. Remember, I was telling you about introspection, which is an important part. So this is an aspect of introspection. So mining your mind, getting those golden nuggets out, is something that most people don't do. And that is where I think the treasure is buried. The second one is obviously gratitude. And I've done lots and lots and lots of podcasts on gratitude, because gratitude is such a powerful tool. Whenever you're feeling low, whenever you're feeling high, whenever something good's happening, whenever something bad's happening, gratitude will always streamline things for you. So gratitude is very important. And which would be my last one that I would choose? I think the last one is something called a sleep primer, which is something that is very cute, which is why I like it. Basically, when you're going to bed, how do you make sure that you're going to have nice thoughts and nice dreams? So can you prime your dreams and your thoughts before you go to bed? So you're lying down in your pillow and you're getting ready for bed and you're snuggling. Can you start visualizing yourself as a bear crawling into a cave with her little cubs, getting ready for bed and getting ready to sleep? So, you know, you can start visualizing those things, and that completely changes the way that you sleep, because your mind is now primed for that sleep activity. So the sleep primer for sure.
Okay. So my top three picks, I would say, would be the first one that I had actually found that it was something different is the habit You had talked about the difference between good habit and a bad habit. Because I am someone who's constantly struggling with habits and I'm not able to differentiate. Like, it's okay if I'm having that pizza. It's okay. I'm just treating myself. So able to distinguish between that and introspection one. You had taught that whenever you're having a thought, you can let it go and you can think about it like not now. That sort of a dialogue that you gave. I believe that was another one that I really liked.
Thank you.
And then there was a alarm clock one, that you have an alarm clock for the entire family that you have to go to bed around this specific time. So even if you're having guests or anyone, you'll make sure that most of the people leave, or I should say, like, I don't have any other nice way to put it across, but
So tata, bye bye. Good night. See you tomorrow.
So yeah. So I believe these three are my favorite ones that I feel that are easy to incorporate. But at the same time, like, I have tried these thoughts. Like, when I'm feeling anxious, I'm like, not now. Let's just feel that I'm excited. A power posing one. I believe that's quite good. Even Amy Cuddy has talked about it.
Absolutely.
On TEDx. I believe that's quite good. Like, just imagine yourself as a superwoman, or imagine yourself doing something great. So giving that pep talk to oneself.
Yes.
Also, so do you do that to yourself as well? Like, do you practice these power poses before going through an interview or?
Yeah, even before we started this right now, I was walking around like this, like Superman. Absolutely. You have to.
Okay.
You go for an important meeting in the lift while you're getting up there. Before you start that important meeting at your client's place, you go to the toilet quickly and you power pose inside there. Very important.
Deep, I do believe there is a, like, mindset change. Like, your body does affect the way your mind reacts, and Simon, vice versa is also true.
Absolutely.
So do you also believe in journaling? They say that there are two ways that you could express yourself or your emotions. One is meditation and second one is journaling. Obviously, you can talk to it about your with your friends or your therapist. But these two are the ones that include you and just you being in the loop. So do you practice these two as well?
Every morning. So I don't know where my book is. Books disappeared, but otherwise, so what I do is my morning journaling practice has changed a little. So earlier on, it used to be free flow writing where you just write down all the thoughts that are going through your head. Now what I do is I start off with a gratitude practice, and I do I'm grateful for three things, and then one aspect of the things that I'm grateful for I introspect on, right? So I'm grateful for this conversation with you about Mitti Kiran. And then I would probably talk about, you know, why am I grateful for this podcast that I was on? What did it make me feel? How was it? Da, 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 da. And then I start thinking about it and I start then introspecting on it, because that's where the ideas start coming from. And like I was talking about mining your mind comes from. The journaling I do when I have a lot of random thoughts running through my head. And obviously I used to do that a lot more earlier. Right now I don't have so many. But every time I do, from time to time, I do my journaling, and that helps me sort out my head from that point of view.
So if there is any tip that you would like to share to our listeners that who are trying to get into habit, myself included, but they do not follow through that typical 21 days challenge. So what do you want to say to them? Like, even if they're skipping a day, keep on going at it, or you should try changing the method that you're doing that trick.
So I don't subscribe to the 21 day rule at all. I think it's not something that I've ever seen work with any of my clients, because life comes in the way, once in a while you might fall sick. Some once in a while you might have to go for a wedding, something or the other will happen. So life comes in the way. So you're never going to have a complete 21 days, 3 weeks of nothing happening. There's always some drama. So as a result, what you do is don't think about it as 21 days in a row. Think about it as never missing 2 days in a row. So even the app that we have designed, the habit coaching app, is all about never missing 2 days in a row. If you don't do it for 2 days, you get minus points. If you do it, you know, you get positive points. So that's how you start playing with it. Because the 2 days in a row is the most important part of your habits.
Okay. So thank you so much for sharing all these positive tips and tricks with us and helping us form that habit with us. Again, going lastly, I would like one more tip from you. During this pandemic, what are the things or greatest learnings that you had? Three greatest learnings that you had during this pandemic.
Three learnings. So the first one is understanding what are your priorities. Okay, where is it that you are currently in terms of what is important in your life, right? going out and eating has gone out of the window. You know, so many things that we took for granted has gone out of the window. Were they needed? God knows. Correct? So learning your priorities on who you are at that point of time. The second important learning is understanding fear. Okay? During this pandemic, we've been all exposed to the fear of the virus more than the virus. Correct? Everyone has been exposed to the fear of the virus. Some of us have been exposed to the virus. The fear is as bad as the virus. Correct? So understanding how we deal with fear is something that I've learned. And I've learned how my family deals with fear, how my friends deal with fear. And that has been a very, very interesting part of this pandemic. And the last one is understanding how society could possibly change in the future, completely could change in the future. And what aspects of it are important? Maybe we might not, maybe we might have different disinfectant ways of when guests come home, different, norms of dealing with each other. If I came to your house, how would we interact with knowing that somebody might have coronavirus? Would I come to your house and immediately you would say, please go have a bath, right? So these are things that are improving and changing. And it's so interesting because, you know, we're learning transparency. We're learning about people who lie, don't lie. So, if you go and meet somebody, it's good manners now to say, you know, just to tell you, I was in an office earlier on, or I went to this place earlier on. So if you don't want to come next to me, whatever. So you are creating that safe space for that person. And I think people who are going to, learn this faster will probably succeed more than people who are being a little cagey about it.
Mm-hmm. I definitely agree with that as well. I believe that the whole Indian culture is about Atithi Devo Bhava, or we have these values, that these cultures or festivals that bring us together. But because of the current scenario, we are not able to celebrate them. We're not able to welcome our guests and all these things. So I believe somewhere we are somewhat missing those values, and we are not able to get in touch, and we are getting more and more connected to the technology.
Did you listen to the podcast with Dr. KK Agarwal, who I had on the Habit Coach?
I don't think so, no.
Please listen to that podcast. Okay, you will love it because he was saying that the Vedas have basically taught us how to deal with coronavirus. And I was like, acha, tell me. And he was saying, see, in the Vedas, what do they say? How do you welcome guests into your home? So he said, there are 16 ways of that you're supposed to welcome a guest. So that's 16 things you have to do. He said, I'll talk only about six. So I said, chalo, tell me. So he said, what is the first thing you have to do? Haath pair dho, correct? So you tell them, please wash your legs. So, you wash your guest's legs. So he said, what is the first thing in our context? Take off your shoes, correct? Clean your feet, because that is where 50 to 60% of the virus is coming in from. Okay. Then what is the next? Haath muh dholo. So you ask them to go wash their hands, right? Wash their hands, muh, iodine gargle, right? So haath muh dholo. Then he said, uske baad kya karte hain? Kuch sweet dete hain, you know, muh meetha karo. So you give them something sweet. If they can taste it, you know that they've not lost their sense of taste, which is one of the things that is a corona symptom. Uske baad, sprinkle them with something sweet smelling, correct? You normally throw rose water. See if they lost the sense of smell, correct? Then in the olden days, it says that there is a special place for your guests and a special place for you. So similarly, right now, you'll have a special place for your guests, you'll have a special place for you. So he said that everything is there. We've just lost it in our culture. And I was like, this is so, because such a nice way of thinking about it, right? And I think once we start living with it and understanding that corona is not going anywhere, right now, we just have COVID-19, next year will be COVID-20, then 21, 22, 23. It's going to be part of our life. So we have to learn how to live with it instead of trying to fight it.
And I do believe that answers to these things are already somewhere in our scriptures. Like they say that if you're having some kind of turmoil or you're experiencing those things, you should read Gita. It has gyan on that. So I believe that there are a lot of scriptures that we have in India that are not given that much importance until and unless someone comes and says that, yeah, you should do these things. For example, yoga itself. We never took yoga seriously. People started outside West started taking it seriously. We started taking it seriously. Intermittent fasting. We were the ones who were very about fasting, about different types of festivals that included fasting. We never took it seriously. Once it
but
came
listen,
from
huh?
outside.
There's a big change here, okay? There's a difference between the way that you're supposed to be doing fasting and mera upas hai. Kya khate ho? Nahi, sabudana khichdi kha rahi ho. Right? Potato chips kha rahi ho. Ferrari chivda kha rahi ho. Okay? Matlab, that is not called fasting. Okay? Fasting is something very pure. This is something that we've completely... What is the polite word to use for this? Messed up. Correct? So fasting
okay,
something
that's
pure.
The polite word.
Yeah, because we messed up fasting, meaning it's supposed to be healing, and you put junk food on top. Sabudana khichdi is one of the worst things you can eat for your body. Worst. Ferrari chivda is the worst thing you can eat for your body. Like, and that is the stuff that we put in when we are supposed to be trying to be pure. So it's not, it doesn't make sense. You know what sabudana khichdi is made of? You know what sabudana is?
Tapioca.
What tapioca?
Tapioca, I believe that there is a like root vegetable tapioca. So you use that powder and then you make sabudana.
It is tapioca starch. Starch is pure sugar. Starch is the thing that we throw out of the rice so that we don't get fat. That is what we are putting basically and turning it into a khichdi and only eating that. So sabudana khichdi is basically eating pure sugar.
Okay. Now that you are saying this, I believe that I have to go through everything in my kitchen and I'll stop eating majority of the thing. Being a vegetarian, I already have very limited options.
Halas.
So you want me to even like further concentrate my diet, and I don't think I'll have anything left to eat after this.
Perfect. Fasting. Then you eat sunlight and fresh air.
Yeah, I have heard about that concept as well. People are like, you don't need food. You just need sunlight. You just need air.
Correct.
And you will be able to survive. People are there who are doing fasting.
Breatharians, they're called.
So yeah, I don't think I'm going to go to such an extreme. But yeah, I'll try to control. I believe that control is the right word for it. I'll try to control on these things.
Nice.
Or do you have a positive word for even control? Like, control sounds too negative.
Actually, it sounds like be mindful.
Okay,
choose
definitely.
It. I will choose correctly.
Okay, I'll try to choose it correctly. Thank you so much for teaching me all through this podcast. Like,
my
how
pleasure.
Should I... if it is like from basics of like how should I use words more from like in a more positive way, or like trying to make changes in the diet, or trying to follow the meditation path. I believe it's a quite wonderful journey that you have out there. So I won't say that I have been completely transformed or something, but I do believe that I have become a better person. I have recommended it to my mother as well. And she has started writing the gratitude journal. So every day I would see, she starts like writing up. She writes in Hindi. So she starts writing like, she has a heading like, achhi cheeze karke. So she writes underneath that, like a list of things that she believes that she's grateful for. Like, main Ishwar ka shukriya ada karti hu, that sort of a thing.
Lovely.
So thank you so much.
Auntie, thank you so much. I hope you add me also onto your gratitude list sometimes.
Definitely. I'll make sure that she does. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
It was lovely having you.
Same here. Thank you.
Thank you.